is Carol Mantel of Boat History Report. She's Director of Business Development for BoatHistoryReport.com. Actively participating as a Vice Chair for the National Association of State Building Law Administration Vessel Identification, Registration, and Titling Committee. Let's try to title himself. Go.
I do apologize. I'm a little nervous. I always get nervous when I come up to speak. And as I walked in, I have a one-month-old who had a blowout. And then once I got that cleaned up, it threw up all over me. So you think I'd be okay? And I'm still nervous. So I apologize in advance. I thought about holding the baby just to make sure you all are really nice. But he's sleeping, so we'll let him sleep. You don't wake a sleeping baby. So my name's Caroline. I'm with BoatHistoryReport.com. Some of you might know me. Some of you might not. I am here to talk to you about the Uniform Security Title for Vessels Act. Has anybody heard of this? All right, I have a couple people. Thank you. And for the rest of you, listen up, because it is pretty important. Give me a second to get my bearings on how this works. So I'm going to start off with a quiz real quick, because I want to make sure you guys understand the importance of this law. So I have a question for you guys. Feel free to shout out the answer if you think you know it. How many registered boats? So these are actively registered boats, meaning boats that are currently available, they're currently in use, they could end up in your brokerage, they could end up in a dealership. These are actively registered boats have some sort of significant negative history in negative event in their history. So in the state of Florida, one in how many do you think have a negative event? One in ten. Okay, you're a little aggressive. Not quite that aggressive. Back it up a little bit. It's one in 28 in the state of Florida. In Palm Beach County, that number is a little bit more dramatic. It's one in 20. And these are actively registered boats, so these are boats that you could see. In Monroe County, do you see a trend here? One in every 15. In Miami-Dade County, we have one in every 12. And now I have one really staggering number for you. So this is in Miami-Dade County. So a lot of boats are coming out of Miami-Dade. So in Miami-Dade County, how many do you think of all time? Now, our state registration data goes back to 1969. So if you look at all boats that have ever been registered in Miami-Dade, how many boats, one in how many, do you think have a negative event in history? Y'all have some numbers. 111? Anyone else? 1 in 8? 1 in 5. I have a little sound effect maybe. Right? 1 in every 5 boats. So what I want you to think about right now is how this affects your brokerage. How many boats does your brokerage have? Or how many boats do you see in a dealership? And how many of those are going to be affected by this law when it's enacted in 2023? And I know 2023, it sounds far away, but it's not, guys. So that's what I want you to think about as I start this presentation. So, what is it, right? The Uniform Certificate of Title for Vessels Act is a total mouthful. Regulates the titling of boats in a manner similar to the way that all states now issue title for automobiles. You guys can read this. I don't need to read it to you. In short, what it is it unifies titling laws and it provides consumer protection. So the thing that we're going to focus on is consumer protection, but the overall, that is what this law is. So who came up with it? So I tried to anticipate the questions you're going to have, so I'm sorry for the cheesy title. But who came up with this thing? So once again, the Uniform Certificate of Title for Vessels Act, and because it's the marine industry, there has to be an acronym, so you'll hear it called UCODA, UCOTBA, UCODA-B. It was created by the Uniform Law Commission in 2011 as a general law that can be adopted at the state level of every state. It's modeled after the Uniform Certificate of Title for Vehicles Act, so that's the law that protects you. Everyone in here has benefited from that law when you went to buy a car and you found out if the car had a clean title. This law is the same on the boating side. So right now, if you advertise that the boat has a clean title, it really doesn't matter because every boat in Florida has a clean title. There could literally be nothing left, and you could tell someone that has a clean title and you're right. It does have a clean title, but that's what's about to change. It was first enacted in Virginia, Connecticut followed suit, D.C., Hawaii, and Florida, which is the important part today, but Florida is the last state to enact it in 2019. And then Georgia is an honorable mention because Georgia actually enacted titling this year. It'll go into effect in July of next year. And it has branding on it, but it's not quite UCODA compliant, so it's not considered a UCODA state. So far, we're at 5 states, the last 2 most recently. It's endorsed by NMMA, National Association of Skateboarding Law Administrators, Build US, the Justice State Legislation, American Bar Association. It's also endorsed by insurers, financiers, Coast Guard. So there's a lot of benefits and protection here. What are those benefits? Well, that's a great question, guys. Thanks for asking. So, the Coast Guard, once the Coast Guard finalizes their state title certification process, security interests that are protected under this law will be given a status of preferred fixed mortgage. So, that's really a great benefit for you guys. It's going to offer more protection to lenders, better rates for buyers. It should help promote commerce. It also is going to help protect consumers from buying unsafe boats through branding. So that, again, is something we're going to touch a little bit more on in a minute. But it is going to provide protections through branding. It's going to help criminal activity and title washing. Does anyone know what title washing is? Anyone? All right. Well, thought I asked you guys. Title washing is when you take a boat and a state of titles to a state that doesn't title. Did you guys know there are 9 states that still don't title boats? So when you take this boat from here and you sell it to somebody in Tennessee and you have yacht closers fill out that information for you, there is no title issued in Tennessee, which means if that boat has a negative brand on it and now it goes to Tennessee, that brand is lost because the title is lost. And there was actually an instance in Tennessee, it was the Pickwick Lake instance, has anyone heard of this? What happened was a dealer was selling a boat, and they told the new owner that they could keep the boat there at the marina. And then they turned around and they sold it to someone else. And they told that person, you can keep it here at the marina. And they went around and they sold it to somebody else. And so they did this a couple of times before they were caught. And the only person that had rights to that boat was the last person to buy it because there was no titling. So this is why this law is important. This is how it unifies titling. So the big goal of this law is to get those last 9 states on board with titling. Recently, 5 additional states have added titling. With Georgia being the last one. Oops. Wrong way. And it's popular with stakeholders. We already kind of talked about that. So wait, is this the Carfax to Boats law thing? You guys heard of this, right? Even if you haven't, pretend you have because it makes me happy. So as I kind of mentioned, it was signed by the governor in June 2019, and it's effective as of July 2023. Again, I know that sounds far away, but there's stuff that has to happen that you guys are going to have an opportunity to influence prior to that happening. So that's why it's really important we're talking about this today.
A new Florida law is lowering the chance of buying a stolen or damaged boat. This is a lot of work that fights out of Scottsdale at Doctors Lake Marina. As news for Jack's reporter Brittany Muller tells us, Governor Ron DeSantis signed a law called the Uniform Certificate of Pilot for Vessels Act.
The law has been called the Carfax for Boats. It's to help prevent boat buyers from buying damaged or stolen boats with more title protection.
Hurricane Harvey, they had 64,000 damaged boats. Those boats end up somewhere.
Rusty Gardner, the president of the Jacksonville Marine Association, says those damaged boats end up with a buyer who doesn't have any idea they're buying a boat that's been damaged or salvaged.
The law is going to be incredibly good for consumers as well as their boat dealers.
The law will provide title protection, meaning it'll help the buyer and the seller to protect the deal. And just like Carfax, under the new law, if a boat has been in an accident, it has to be reported. That way, voters can see the history.
There's some purchasing of a boat going through the hospital trying to find a boat that is well taken care of. That information needs to be really helpful.
Florida has one of the highest numbers of boat deaths in the country, according to the National Insurance Crime Bureau. The latest numbers through this April show more than 1,100 deaths. Have you ever fallen victim to that, or do you know someone?
You know, I have. I've known many dealers in Jacksonville that have had boats stolen off their lot. We've had people who have engines stolen off their boats.
And Florida cities leading the list, Miami, Fort Lauderdale, and Tampa are the top 3 for stolen boats. Jacksonville also on the NICB list with 20 deaths in 2018. The law will go into effect in 2023. Reporting from Fleming Island, Brittany Muller, Channel 4, the local station. All right, so I know what your next question is. Why should I care, right? That is the question. So as I kind of talked about, you need to consider your brokerage, consider how many boats you have and what the average number of significantly damaged vessels is. Remember, this is significant damage, this isn't dock rash or minor repairs.
So the definition, so we're adding branding to whole damn especially. That's one of the big things that's going to change in 2023. What is the definition of a whole damn especially, right? Because it could be anything. This is the definition straight from the law itself. Whole damage means compromise with respect to the integrity of a vessel's hull by collision, allision, lightning strike, fire, explosion, running aground, or similar occurrence, or the sinking of a vessel in a manner that creates a significant risk to the integrity of the vessel's hull. So I know what your next question is going to be, because it was my next question. Well, what determines if it was a significant risk to the integrity of the vessel's hull? And unfortunately, there is no true answer to that right now, and that's where you guys are, it's really important for you guys to pay attention. So in the next 3.5 years, they are going to work on regulation that's going to address these exact questions. So there will be regulation put in place to further clarify what will be used to determine that lowest point of what should be considered full damage. I will make sure to keep EVA informed on the process as it comes along and regulation is being talked about so that you guys have an opportunity to provide input as well, because that's definitely the thing that will affect you the most. Who is going to report the information? Another good question. You guys are great with the questions today. So who reports this? Insurance companies are going to report it. They're going to be required to report it anytime you transfer ownership of the vessel because it was a total loss vessel. So if they pay out the vessel, they take ownership of it, it will be reported, and that will show on the title. Vessel owners are also required to report it. You guys can all laugh, right? All of us can laugh about that because that doesn't seem like it's going to happen. But there are going to be consequences for vessel owners who don't report it. Your first occurrence of not reporting a hull damage to occur to the vessel while it was under your ownership will be a fine of $5,000. The second occurrence is $15,000, and the third occurrence is $25,000. And after that, they probably don't have to buy boats anymore. So those are the consequences. So there are significant consequences. Florida imposed significantly higher consequences. The uniform commercial code for this had a fine of $1,000, and Florida's taking it much more seriously. So they are going to be looking to pursue this because it's important for our state. With all of the hurricane damage boats that are out there, there are a lot of boats that are going to be affected by this. I know that one of your questions, I don't have it in here, is going to be, and I want to answer them now because the only thing keeping you from cocktails are questions when I'm done in a minute. So let me answer them now. Except I just totally forgot what the question was. I had a question that I was going to answer for you, and I don't remember what it is, so we'll come back to that. I don't even know that. I've got baby brain. I'm sorry. It's a real thing. Go ahead. No, it's going to be entirely up to the insurance company and the vessel owner to report it. It's a great question, and that might be something that they decide to include in regulations. Again, that's why it's really important for you guys to be involved in that process so that we can make suggestions like that. And you want to make suggestions like that because we're all ethical brokers in this room. Well, I'm not a broker, but...
So we're not taking directly in the environment of deregulation that we experience so far, and the scientists are very adamant about deregulation, how do we get an additional regulation for the consequences? Is it being consumer protection?
It is being consumer protection. That's a great question. Yes. And that's going to be one of the, so one of the questions that I had when I was in the process of helping this move forward in the state was how are we going to call somebody out for not reporting it, right? And that is a tricky one because it's going to require a marine survey done on the vessel, or it's going to require a repair yard saying, hey, there's this much damage. It's going to require a lawsuit potentially, but it is going to be the Attorney General who's going to get in the middle of this as a consumer protection issue, and they will pursue it. So it is something that they're taking very seriously in this too.
What happens if you're out on the boat and the engine blows up, but it really doesn't do anything to the hull? And then you're going to have an engine study. Is the engine surveyor going to be required to implement or make sure that you register this now?
This is the integrity of the hull. Yeah. So is this
supposed to devalue the boat, I mean, in the long term? Because a lot of times you can take the boat to a boat yard and have, you know, the fiberglass repaired, and it doesn't really do anything to the integrity of the hull.
Right. So that is the one key point that we need to focus on is the integrity of the hold. We're looking at it from a safety standpoint. So does it jeopardize the safety? When you take your family out on this boat or the next owner takes their family out, does it jeopardize their safety on the water? And that's the one thing that you really need to look at. But that's a great question. And again, these are questions that are going to come up as we look at that regulatory process. So big deal, why else, right? Oh, is that not enough for you? Well, let me help you understand why else. You guys are all members of this awesome organization that has a great code of ethics. So let's just look at two of those real quick. Section one, the very first one, guys, that's a big deal. It's the duty of the members to protect the public against fraud, misrepresentation, or unethical practices in the yacht brokerage profession. Members should endeavor to eliminate any practices which could be damaging to the public or the dignity and integrity of the yacht brokerage profession. And Section 21 actually deals with what we just talked about and why it's important for you guys to be up to date on this. In justice to those who place their interest in his care, the members should endeavor always to be informed regarding laws, proposed legislation, governmental orders, and other essential information and public policies to protect those interests. If anyone in here is also CCYB Code of Ethics, they have two very similar articles in there, actually similar to Section 1, where again, it's your job to protect against fraud. So why were we involved? Why was I involved? So I'm the vice chair for the National Association of State Boating Law Administrators Special Identification, Registration, and Title Committee. That's a lot, right? NASBA vote. That's a really long acronym, and it takes a long time to say, so I'm not going to repeat it. But this was a charge. This was something that was near and dear to my heart. That's actually why I got involved. My company, voted to report, more like the contest for votes. And our whole mission is greater transparency in safer voting. So it just makes sense. Anything that's good for the industry is good for everybody in the industry. And the goal is to make voting safer. And unfortunately, when you have a hurricane and you have all these damaged boats and there's all these articles about damaged boats, and every hurricane video and photo you see shows the damaged boats. So what we want to do is help voters and new voters that come to this state and people that are looking to get into the industry understand that there are safeguards in place that help protect you when you're looking to buy a boat. You don't want to buy a boat that has a negative history, and this is just one of the things that will be in place. I remember what my question was before. When this is enacted, will it go back and add any boat that was previously damaged prior to July 2023? The answer is no. So it will be from July 2023 going forward that whole damage will be included. So you'll still have the opportunity to verify the history through companies like ourselves or whoever it is that you want to work with. But from 2023 going forward is when this will take effect. So do you have any more questions? The one thing I forgot to put in here is what the actual bill number is. It's House Bill 475. So if you want to take a look and look that up, you can actually read the whole bill. It's about 86 pages. So I'm proud of myself for getting it done in like 20 minutes. But there's not that many significant changes to the actual titling process for you guys. You don't have to worry about a lot of stuff happening there. The big change, like I said, is going to be this branding, this negative branding. And I will keep you guys informed on when you have an opportunity to provide some insight. So if you have any questions, I'm also going to be out there for a couple minutes. If you don't mind a crying baby, I might be out there. House Bill 475. I just want to say thank you to Paul and you guys for having me.
Thank you very much, Kevin. Does anyone else have any questions for Kelly?
And you can ask me out there if you don't want to be bombarded by everybody in here for delaying the process.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.